Hey everyone, Alex here. Now today I want to go over the tune-up of a bandsaw, the basics, because a lot of people make the mistake of adjusting the blade incorrectly, tension guides, all of that. So I'm going to go over the basics for you here. First of all, when you install your blade, one of the biggest mistakes that people make is putting the blade in the wrong spot. One of the problems is a bandsaw wheel has a crown from front to back. So when you center the blade right in the middle of the wheel, all you're doing is giving it a pivot point. So what you want to do is you want to back the blade up so that the deepest part of the gullet, the deepest part of the tooth, is right in the center of the wheel. What this does is it actually puts all the tension and rigidity at the cutting edge, not the middle of the blade, giving it a pivot point. And when you put it all that tension on the cutting edge, well then, when you cut, you're using leverage to track the blade, not force. To give you a little different of an example, if this were the blade and this were the middle of the wheel, well, we'd have a big old pivot. By putting all that tension and rigidity up here, the only thing that these side guides have to do is to prevent the back edge from fishtailing instead of forcing the front edge where you want it to go. We're actually using leverage, not force, to direct where the blade goes. So, I've got this set up. I'm going to rotate that until I'm sure that that deepest part of that gullet is right there in the center of the wheel, which we have set up there. And then we know that the bottom is going to ride forward. Now I've already set up the bottom so we don't have to get up underneath the table to do this. But remember, the blade always rides forward on the bottom because they don't want the blade entering at the top before the bottom so it doesn't roll everything up into the blade. So there are six steps that I like to make sure that are right. Step number one, deepest part of the gullet, center of the wheel, is done. Step two, tension. Now, tension is a preference. I will tell you the little gauges, they can work and cannot work. And the reason that I say that is they're set from the factory with a perfect length blade. Here's the problem. When you buy a blade, it's been tooth matched when it was welded together so that the teeth don't get too close together and you don't get that tick, tick, tick. So, let's say it's off by an eighth of an inch, and that's being extremely generous. That means the gauge could be off by a quarter of an inch because there are two sides to the blade. So that's why I don't exactly like to rely on those gauges when it comes to perfect tension. The way that I set up my tension, number one, I never check on the right-hand side. Reason being, you have a guide, guard, table, insert, all that giving the blade resistance, and I could check here, here, and here, and get three completely different feels because I'm three completely different distances from the wheel. I always like to open up the door, lay my finger right here on top of this guard, and tap as hard as you would like. You should never be able to get much more than about a quarter of an inch deflection, tapping on the blade as hard as you would like. Anything less than that can give that blade a little bit of deflection. So, we've got step two done, our tension. Step three. Now this is a bonus that we get by always putting the deepest part of the gullet in the center of the wheel, and that is the side guides that we adjust front to back to compensate for the different size blades. Once we adjust them and set them so that the front edge of whatever you're using for side guides is just behind the deepest part of the gullet, we shouldn't have to adjust them anymore. Reason being, if you always put the deepest part of the gullet in the center of the wheel, doesn't matter what size blade you put up there, they always line up in the perfect spot. So we're getting a little bonus out of this. So the reason we don't want those side guides to come into the gullet is it can take the set out of those teeth. And one of the biggest issues with bandsaw blades, they don't so much dull as they come into a line more often. So once a blade forms a knife edge, it's going to try to seek the easiest route through the wood. So always make sure that whatever you're using for side guides, it's just behind the deepest part of that gullet. So we've got step three done. Step four, and I think this step is almost as critical as where that blade rides, and that is our thrust bearing. We want that thrust bearing close, but not so close that it touches or turns before you begin to cut. If that thrust bearing's touching or turning before you begin to cut, what you're doing is you're pushing on the back edge of the blade, causing that front to tweak one way or the other. Generally the second reason you're going to get drift. So what we want to do is we want to actually just bring that up to the back edge of the blade and then back it away just about a thousandth or a few thousandths of an inch. That way when we roll this wheel, that bearing doesn't turn, but the moment that you put that very little bit of pressure on it, it actually causes that bearing to turn. And make sure that top and bottom are the same. Should be able to touch right here in the center, they should both turn. When we rotate the wheel, neither of them should turn. So now we've got step four done. Now, step five is those side guides. Remember, you've always been told to use feeler gauges and dollar bills and tape and anything you can to get them as close as possible. All you're doing is destroying your blade prematurely. And the reason that I say that, any time that steel has been yielded, fancy word for being bent, every tooth has been bent. And you put friction or heat anywhere in the body of that blade, that tooth wants to come back to its original state. Remember, friction and heat are your number one destroyer of a bandsaw blade. So, all we need to do is just leave a little bit of daylight between the blade and the guide, and I'm going to show you why. We've got that set. That's not rolling. These are free, but they're close. Here's the reason why we don't have to have those side guides so close. Remember when I started, I said that we were using leverage, not force, to direct where that blade goes? Well, if you put all the tension and rigidity in the middle of the blade, if the back moves an inch, the front moves an inch. Back moves an inch, front moves an inch. By putting all that tension and rigidity at the cutting edge and not the middle of the blade, now when I move the back an inch, the front moves 1/10 the amount. That's why we don't have to have those side guides so close. And again, we're using leverage, not force, to direct where that blade goes. All right, so next we want to set up our table square to the blade. Now, you can take a small square and measure each side to try to make sure that table is good and level. I'm going to show you the easiest way there is to make sure your table is good and square. If you'll just take a piece of 1x or anything that you've got jointed on one edge, just bring that down just above our work. And make sure that you've got that jointed edge down. Make a simple cut into the material. Rotate that around. If that blade goes back into that cut, we know we're level across the whole surface of the table, not just up one side or the other. Super easy way of making sure that your table is good and square. Now, the next thing that a lot of folks forget is squaring their fence to the blade. You got to remember, if that fence isn't square to the body of the blade, it's going to want to kind of push that back edge one way or the other. So we want to make sure that fence is square. And I'll tell you, whether you're using the original fence or say you're doing some angled cuts where you need that mag fence so that it'll basically pull right down to the table, you want to make sure that they're square again to the body of the blade, because when you cut, if the fence is angled, when it gets to the back side, it's going to push that back side one way or the other. The easy way to do this is with a set of fasts. Now, fasts are a fence alignment system tool. You'll notice it has a magnet for the body of the blade. It has a groove for the offset of the teeth. So we just simply drop that onto the blade so that the teeth are in that groove. That way we don't skew off to the offset of the teeth. We're actually flat to the body of the blade. That way I can bring that right over to it and lock it down, and I know that it's square. Let's say I wanted to get 2 inches away. The nice thing about the fast, they do come in a set of five. So we just simply measure over on the back 2 inches, the front 2 inches. I know I'm square and I'm 2 inches away. And since they're magnetic, they're always pretty darn handy. Now I've already got this fence set up square, so I'm going to set it for about a half inch here. We'll make sure this is tight. Y'all got to see me tune this saw up literally by tensioning it and getting everything set right here in front of you. All right, now we've got this saw set up. Let's see how well we did. Safety first. Bandsaw should never ever have drift. Anyone that tells you that they do does not set the saw up right. They should never ever drift. They should always cut perfectly straight.